Burgundy hymnal. You'll find it under your pew, hymn number 267.
Is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please take time and share God's peace with one another today. God's peace.
Thank you. Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for the blessing of being together, celebrating Palm Sunday and anticipating the week to come. We ask your blessing on this time together that we may live and learn and grow into you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Going to invite you now to stand again, and we're going to sing a song, and then after that, it's an opportunity for us to be seated, and our scripture readers will come forward, and we'll hear now, after that, the story of Jesus' passion, his suffering and death on the cross. So please stand now as we sing.
And we'll be singing Open Our Eyes, Lord, number 98, not 134.
Please be seated, and now I'll invite our scripture readers forward to take their places, and I invite all of you to find the scripture reading, the Passion of our Lord, according to Matthew, in your bulletin. If you're worshiping online today, there is a link in the All Church email to this Passion reading. We all have a part in this. Please, when we get to the part marked in the bold, please respond. This is the Passion of our Lord, according to Matthew.
Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
"You say so."
But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him,
"Do you not hear how many accusations they make against you?"
But he gave him no answer, not even a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now, at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So, after they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you?"
"Whom do you want me to release to you? Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who is called the Messiah?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent him word, "Have nothing to do with the innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him." Now the chief priest and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them,
Which of the two do you want me to release to you?
Barabbas.
Then what should I do with the Jesus called the Messiah?
Let him be crucified.
Why? What evil has he done?
But they shouted all the more,
let him be crucified.
So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands and before the crowd, saying,
I am innocent of this man's blood. See to this yourselves.
Then the people as a whole answered,
his blood be on us and on our children.
So he released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying,
Hail, King of the Jews!
They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him, and they led him away to be crucified. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross, and when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means a place of skulls, they offered him wine to drink, mixed with gall. But when he tested it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. And they sat down there and kept watch over him. Over his head, they put a charge against him, which read, This is Jesus, the King of the Jews. Then two bandits were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross.
In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying,
He saved others. He cannot save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now, if he wants to. For he said, I am God's son.
The bandits, who were crucified with him, also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried out with a loud voice,
Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani.
That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
This man is calling for Elijah.
At once, one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick and gave it to him to drink. But the other said,
Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him.
Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last breath. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn into two, from the top to the bottom. The earth shook, the rocks were split, the tombs were also open, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now, when the centurions and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said,
Truly this man was God's son. Amen.
I'm going to invite now children who would like to go to children's worship time to follow Miss Jaina and they'll be back later on in the worship service. And as they do that, let's take some quiet time of reflection, and then I'll share some words. This past Wednesday evening, we gathered at peace to do something that we do traditionally each Lent, and that's a prayer walk in the neighborhood, praying at the corners, four corners of this block. We prayed for the future directions that God has given us as a church moving into God's future. And as we walked, it was a kind of a march. Then, just a few minutes ago, we were gathered in the big room and we waved our palm branches and we marched, singing, "We are marching in the light of God," into the sanctuary. Placed the palms down. Marching. Marching. During the faith education hour, in this season of Lent, each of these Sundays, we've been journeying with Lenten reflections on the spirituals, those songs that were born out of the tragedy and the suffering of African-American slaves in the United States. And it was a powerful series, lifting up themes of sorrow and lament, courage and resilience and hope in God. There's one of the spirituals that we looked at, and thanks be to God, to Lynn Longfield and to so many musicians who helped us on this journey. The one spiritual that I'm thinking about today is called "We Will March Through the Valley." It says, "We will march through the valley in peace. If Jesus himself be our leader, we will march through the valley in peace." We've been using this devotional book by Luke Powery. It's called "Were You There? Lenten Reflections on the Spirituals." And Powery talks about how there's a difference between marching and walking, right? When you're marching, it's intentional. And marching is about determination, energy, focus, sheer will to march. Think of Dr. King's March on Washington. When you're marching, you have a destination where you're going. Spirituals draw on the language in this spiritual. We will march through the valley of Psalm 23, right? The valley of the shadow of death. How is it possible to march, to walk intentionally through the valley of death? We hear the wisdom of the spiritual. If Jesus himself is our leader, we will march through the valley in peace. Amen? If Jesus is our leader, we can march through the valley of death. Marches, processions of people intentionally walking, speak of values and commitments. My wife Lee and I, Friday night, went to the Rialto Theater to see this new opera. I'm not usually an opera person, but it was powerful. It's called the Tacoma Method. Maybe some of you were able to see that. It is telling the story of the 19th century. Did you know that the Chinese community in Tacoma in the 19th century made up a tenth of the population of Tacoma? And then in 1885, city leaders and a crowd forcibly marched all the Chinese folks who were in the city out of the city and burned their businesses, burned their homes for them never to return. That was a march. That's the reason Tacoma doesn't have a Chinatown today. It spoke of values and commitments, didn't it? White supremacy, racism. Last October, my family participated in what was called the Walk for Reconciliation Against Racism. I know some of you did that too. And it was put on by the Chinese Reconciliation Park Foundation. It was another march led by Tacoma City leaders. And this one reversed the direction of that 1885 Chinese exclusion march, ending up on Schuster Parkway at the Chinese Reconciliation Park, near where the original Chinese businesses and houses were located. And it also was a statement of values and commitments, of hopes, saying our city stands with our immigrant and minority communities, and our city stands against racism and oppression. And we know we need to live into those values and commitments, don't we? So, let's look at the gospel today from Matthew. Scholars say that two marches, two processions, came into Jerusalem at about the same time, at the beginning of that week of the Jewish festival of Passover that year. On one side of town, Jesus entered, humble, riding on a donkey. As folks gathered and waved their palm branches and put their cloaks down on his path and walked with him, marched with him into the city. They shouted, Hosanna, which means, O save, O King, save us. And then on the other side of town, there was Pontius Pilate. Think of the contrast. The Roman governor, the grand imperial parade, chariots and war horses. And instead of folks gathering, waving palm branches, you had guards marching, carrying spears, carrying swords. A powerful display. Think of the contrast. Pilate's march showed the power of empire, military, political, economic power of some over others, what we could call the domination system. Many religious leaders of the day participate in that domination system. We see that happening in our reading today. But Jesus' march has a different vision, doesn't it? It's a vision of the kingdom of God. The people who gather don't gather to celebrate the one who comes in the name of Caesar or the Roman Empire. They gather to celebrate the one who comes in the name of the Lord God. And it's not a powerful display, Jesus' march, of imperial might, war horses, and chariots. This is following Jesus, the King of Peace. So the two marches are going to collide. It is inevitable that they collide. And two themes emerge in that week that we now call Holy Week. The theme of Jesus first confronting the systems and the powers that dominate people. And the second theme, his crucifixion and his resurrection. Christian writer Brian McLaren says, people and societies operate out of a framing story. That's a story that provides the framework for them to live, like a worldview, gives values, gives direction, gives purpose, vision for their lives. And he says, the most common framing story in our world today is deeply destructive to our global community. It is about greed and materialism and inequity and injustice and environmental abuse. It's about violent power, power through violence. It's the same framing story of the Roman Empire and the collaborating religious leaders of the day. We see it again and again in our day. It's a framing story that says that peace comes when you identify a scapegoat, somebody to blame. People who are black, Chinese, Japanese, Ukrainian, immigrants, poor, LGBTQ, you name it. And you get rid of them or you oppress them in order to maintain the status quo with the people who were on top staying on top. You can see that's how it went with Jesus. But Jesus, yes, praise God, confronts that framing story and offers with his life an alternative story, an alternative vision. It's the kingdom of God. What is it all about? We look in Jesus' life, his preaching, teaching, healing, hanging out, eating with people who were considered outsiders, getting angry at injustice, serving, being together with all people, lifting up those who are pushed down and giving his life. We see that this framing story, this kingdom of God, is not about competition. It's about community. It's not about revenge, but forgiveness. It's not about peace through violence. It's peace through justice. It's not about scarcity and fear. It's about abundance and hope. Amen? It's not about selfishness. It's about service. It's not about the love of power. It's about the power of love. Yes, this is the way of Jesus. This is the framing story of God. This is God's kingdom. And in this kingdom, the king gives all he is, his whole self for all people. Opening his arms out of love for all, without condition, without reservation. Thanks be to God, embracing the whole world. It's ironic. I was talking with the confirmation students today, the 7th and 8th graders, about this, and they noticed this. It's ironic that the cross is the center of the framing story of Jesus, because it's the center of the framing story of the Roman Empire, isn't it? It's the symbol, the ultimate symbol of Roman power, that you can get rid of people by putting them to death. And powerfully, God transforms it And it sounds like it's weakness. It's failure. It's an utter waste. But through the eyes of faith, the cross is the center of it all. It's the deep symbol of life and salvation and peace that only comes from God. That's the mystery of Holy Week that I'm inviting you into. I invite you to ponder this deeply. This is Passion Sunday as well as Palm Sunday. Passion means intensity, right? Deep emotion. It also means suffering. And so all that comes together as we see that Jesus lives out a passion for the kingdom of God, and that deep passion leads to his suffering and death on the cross. It's a passion of love. He lived and died this passion, and he invites us, his followers, to share the passion, to let his framing story shape our lives so that we are shaped into people who love and serve and give who we are for others. Let this story do its work on you this week. You and I had a chance to enter into the Passion reading, and as we did, I hope you noticed how that crowd, we were in essence part of the crowd welcoming Jesus, celebrating his entrance, and then we're part of the crowd that was turning on him and wanting to crucify him, right? We also remember how the disciples who walked with Jesus for such a long time then, how quickly they left him. They betrayed him. They denied they even knew him. Isn't it true about us that we can be drawn, we can be tempted to take on that framing story of the empire? We can be led to choose the way of Caesar instead of the way of Jesus, the way of selfishness instead of love. But thanks be to God, we see that God is so patient and so forgiving. We see that no matter what, God's love does not change. God's love for us does not change with our changing moods and our whims. God's love, no matter how far we wander, is always there for us. God is always there, no matter how much we hurt one another, no matter the mistakes we make, to welcome us back to God and the way of Jesus. God will never leave us, never, never, never. Thanks be to God. God has come to us in Jesus to reveal God's deep love for us, and it's a love that will go to the greatest lengths possible to reach us. It's a love that is stronger than any other principality or power in this world. It's a love that invites us to live and to walk, to march in God's light. Did you notice we spoke these words too at the very end of the Passion reading? The ones representing this domination system, keeping watch over Jesus, are so moved by God's power that they recognize Jesus as God's Son. Wow. Two marches entered Jerusalem that day, both speaking strongly of values and commitments. Which one will you choose to join? What is your definition of peace going to be? What will be your framing story? To what, to whom will you give your life? If Jesus himself be our leader, we will march through the valley of peace. Amen. We're going to move into our prayers now, and we'll collect the celebrations and the concerns of the people, and then Kit will lift them up to God in prayer. I'll come to you if you have a celebration, a Thanksgiving today to share.
Have a celebration. I have my oldest granddaughter has special needs, and she's going to be 27 on April 15th.
Praise God. Wonderful.
Yeah, the celebration yesterday was Brendan's 8th anniversary on staff at Peace Lutheran Church, 10 years total at Peace Community Center and Church. So just want to thank God for our brother.
Praise God. Thanks be to God for Brendan. Yes. Come to you if you've got something here. Okay.
I wanted to praise God for our intercultural week we had at Mount Tahoma High School. I had never experienced it. It was my first year here, but they talked about it. They said it was great, a celebration of cultures, and it was just really neat to see the students there embrace each other, their cultures, their differences. They supported each other. They appreciated dancing and music that we did in assembly on Friday. It was just heartwarming to be able to see the student body come together that way and celebrate each other's culture. It was really nice.
Cool. Praise God.
Just celebrating a grandpa visitor from Colorado. Came for spring break.
Welcome, welcome.
Just a prayer of thanksgiving for my time here at Peace. It's been quite a journey, and I'm just grateful that I was sent here. It was such a difficult transition, but I'm so glad that I did. And also just another prayer of thanksgiving that I'll be turning 40 next week, and just grateful for... grateful for... 40 years, and I'm definitely feeling 40. So, just grateful.
It's a significant Bible number, so that's good. Any other Thanksgivings? Okay. What, concerns, Kit? Concerns? Are you? Yep. How about if we gather concerns that people might have? Prayers.
Continue to pray for my mother in Idaho Falls. She does have cancer. Keep her in prayer, and also my mother-in-law. She's been bedridden. Keep her in prayer.
Prayers for my older brother and his fiancée. They're going through a really rough patch right now, and just prayers that they find peace and solutions to the problems they're having right now.
Prayers for my my co-worker, sorry, and her recovery after surgery for ovarian cancer.
I want to pray for Jeannie because if it wasn't for her, I wouldn't be here. I said I want to pray for Jeannie because Jeannie, if it wasn't for her, I wouldn't be here.
Thanks be to God for you, Jeannie, and prayers for you. Thank you, Rhonda.
Prayers for Larry Trey Marshall, who was a student at Foss that was shot and killed on Wednesday, and for his family, his sister Bree, who's a senior at Foss, and just all his family as they grieve him, and all of our Foss community as we grieve the loss of one of our own, and just that God will guide us through this really difficult time.
Yes, and adding prayers for you, Trevor, and for all teachers and the whole community in this time. And a prayer, a deep prayer, for an end to gun violence and recognizing the loss of life of so many young people. So deeply tragic and sad. Others?
I have online from Anita, prayers for Ricardo to stay on the right path as he is working in the Seattle Health Board here in Seattle as a janitor going on 6 months.
And lifting up also Sandra Puckett, who is hospitalized again, and prayers for hope for her, for healing, for understanding, for the doctors in her complicated situation, also for Vera Parks, who is in a care center following a two-month journey that started in the hospital, and it's been long for her. Prayers also for all impacted by tornadoes in our nation, devastating tornadoes.
Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for being the God of love and peace, of caring for us,
We thank you for the celebrations and joys we have in our life, and thank you that you allow us to lift up our concerns and that you take them upon yourself. We thank you and praise you for who you are. We hope that we can frame our lives with you as our framework of our life. Lead us and guide us in this holy week to contemplate all that you went through, and you know what we go through. Yeah. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
You love us all. For we remember in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Please join me in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. This is our Lord's meal, and it's a meal in which we remember Jesus giving of his whole life for us, his body broken, his blood shed for us out of deep love for our salvation. And as we remember, we also receive, and we are filled with God's love and forgiveness, and we are sent into the world to be followers, following the way of Jesus. Thanks be to God for this experience of Jesus' love. Please know that the dark cup here is the wine, the light cup is the grape juice. We have a gluten-free option for bread. If you would like that, just let me know. We have some prepackaged communion here. Let me know if you would like that too. Also, we'll have in this prayer corner prayer ministers ready to pray one-on-one with folks who would desire that. Individual prayer for help or for comfort, for encouragement, for healing in your life, and they'll be here right after worship too. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Amen.
Thank you.
It's the first Sunday of the month, and we bless and we send out communion ministers to make home visits to bring communion to folks. So are there folks who are communion ministers in our midst today? Come on up. And you can tell us whom you will be visiting. And then we'll have a prayer blessing.
Vera Parks.
Vera Parks.
Jerry Hall.
Ted and Billy Johnstone and Carol Plain.
God, we pray your blessing on these gifts of Holy Communion, our communion ministers, and all who will receive, that all may feel your deep and abiding presence, the good news of your love in Jesus, and a connection to Peace Lutheran Church. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand as you're able and receive words of blessing before we go. The body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. May God bless you to be a blessing this week, and may this week be a holy one for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Invitation to take a palm or several palm branches home as a reminder of today and something to use during this week for your devotional meditation. There's refreshments and fellowship in the big room. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.